So Angelina gave a great introduction to web confidence, and I'm just going to extend on that and talk about how we can use it with CSS favorite spec that you like. And before I go forward with web confidence, I had an incident that I thought would be a good representation or a metaphor for what web development is. So this is my iPhone, the back of my iPhone. There is something wrong with it. If you are in front, you kind of can see there's something wrong. It's not the stickers of scowling bunnies which are playing football. And this is exactly how I'd look if you asked me to play football. But there's a cellophane tape on it, which doesn't look too bad. It's a cellophane tape. But if you look in the front, you would notice it's all shattered. And this glass is held together by this cellophane tape. And I thought this was a good metaphor for web development, because even though it's shattered, I can still use it. Like, it still works. So in a way, the way the web is completely unstructured. And everything you do is through this narrow view of this kind of a shattered glass. And it always has you make mistakes. Like, there's no default way to not make mistakes. And there's always conflicts, and there's always things messing up. And it's almost like, you know, you are asked to go into a room full of diamonds and shattered glass. And you're supposed to pick those diamonds up without making sure you don't bleed to death while stepping on those shattered glass. But now with web confidence, and I think what you get now with web confidence is a way to get a dustbin to sweep off the broken glass, and then, you know, you make your merry way around the room, get the diamonds as and when you feel like it. Or in the case of my iPhone, it will be the $30 screen replacement that you would hopefully get to replace your iPhone screen with and start using the iPhone as it was before. So with that introduction to web confidence, the first thing that you should know is, can I use is definitely no. Please do not use it ever for now. But please experiment with it. Like, can I experiment? Yes, always. Please do that. And what you should be doing is experiment with it, give feedback to the spec editors, maybe write something with it, see how your existing components can port over to this web component spec, and basically make sure that it does not suck, because a lot of current web APIs suck big time. So we don't want to replicate that kind of error again with something as big and as encompassing as web component specifications. So first thing to note is it's Chrome only. It's not even like a WebKit only thing. It's a Chrome only thing. It's also very hard to debug, because you have separating concerns that is different components in different pages and different files. So if you're still interested, the way you would go forward is enable flags in Chrome Canary. So first, there's a flag called experimental support for WebKit experiments. And that would give you shadow DOM. That would give you CSS variables. That will give you CSS regions. And there's also another flag for CSS shaders, which I'll talk about. So enabling these two flags will give you everything that you need to follow along with this talk. And then if you're doing developer tools, you do want to, you know, be sane. So to do that, you have to enable show shadow DOM. And then Angelina talked about the polyfill that we'll be using. And this is the polyfill that exactly replicates the spec that encompasses, well, the bunch of specs that encompasses the web components specifications. And so it has all the APIs and everything that is necessary to start using the you know, the spec, at least as an experiment. So the essentials of web components, there are like four specifications that form the part of the web components spec, and there's one that I'm never going to talk about because I completely hate it, and it's called the decorators. Please never talk of it again, and hopefully if you're giving feedback, tell them that you hate it too. But if you really like it, or if you want to find out more about it, just Google for decorators web components. You'll find information about it. But the first thing that's part of the web components spec is the shadow DOM, and you've heard enough of it, so I'm not going to bother telling you what it is. Then you have the custom elements, and one thing to note is all of these specifications can be used on their own. Like, you don't have to use them all together. You can use them separately. They all have their own benefits. So the way you'd use a custom element is you would have an element, and then you would extend a native HTML tag that most closely matches the custom element that you're going to use. And then you'll have a name, and then you'll put a bunch of HTML, CSS, script, whatnot. So the way you would use it is you will have this same HTML tag that you used in the extend attribute value and then say is that custom element. And you can't use, so here in this example, I have a button. So in the definition, I had, where did it go? So in the definition, I had extends button. So I have to use a button tag here. I can't use a div or a span or anything like that. So then you have templates. So templates, again, can be used on their own. So you use a template tag. And then you would put content within the content tag. And as Angelina said, you'll use the select attribute to select the kind of content that will form the part of the template. So let's look at an example. So this is an example of how web components would work. So if you notice the markup, you have just two buttons, and they say, click me, it's the same. But one of the buttons has the is attribute, and one doesn't. And the nature of HTML buttons is that they do nothing until you associate an action with them. So here, it appears like they are both buttons, in which case they should both do nothing. Like when I click on this, click me, nothing happens, which is valid. That's exactly how it should look like. But in this click me, you notice, first of all, there's an ASCII character, which typically you would not expect it to have, but it's a custom element. So when I click it, I have statements that are, you know, it's a good stress release. But so the reason why we do this is how it happens is first you have the link rel is equal to components, and I have the components in this file. So if you go to that component, I have an element, and then I have name, and then I have the template, and whatever is within the template becomes part of that new instance of that new custom element that I just created. And I have a span. We look into the variable a little bit later. Then I have that ASCII character, and then the again, where I'm putting this content. And then this is the script that's getting triggered. If you notice, I don't just simply have this dot on click is equal to function. That will not fly because this script needs to run every time that Shadow DOM has been instantiated. So there's a lifecycle API that you can use, and then you can say which functions need to be executed as soon as the Shadow DOM is created. So I have a created, and then I have a function that I'm executing, and that's what is triggering the console.log statements. So let's look at how the web components work with other specs that we love, especially for me. I really like regions. Regions is a new CSS specification that allows you to flow content irrespective of the document source order. So you may have a H1 on the top, and then if you want, if you use regions, you can do display the H1 at the bottom or wherever you like. And the way this would work is you would have a bunch of selectors, and you would say the content of those selectors would be part of what is known as named flow. And then you would have another bunch of selectors, and you would then declare those selectors to be containers for that named flow. And so the syntax would look like, so you'll have the selector, and then you'll say flow into, and then you have a named flow called region flow here. And then you'll have the container selectors, and then you'll say flow from, and it'll just display the content from that named flow. So what happens is, as soon as you say flow into, that selector becomes empty, like it's almost like it's display none. And then the containers, if they already had content, that will not be displayed anymore. It will only display the content from that named flow. So here is how a Shadow DOM would, a region would look like. This is without the Shadow DOM. Let's look at, so you have, wait, oh, this is with Shadow DOM, sorry. So this is without the Shadow DOM. If you notice, you have the content as a section, and then all the paragraph elements have the text, and then I have a layout. And if you notice, I have a WebKit flow into, and I have a flow called poem flow. Does anyone know what poem this is? What? Wow. I was expecting Angus to answer, but apparently someone else is answering this. I didn't know you guys were all literature majors. But anyway, so this is the poem called The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. So you would have a flow into, so you can also debug this. There's an experimental mode to debug regions. And so you'll see all the named flows, and then you'll have the content that is in that flow, and the regions that is that it will be displayed in. So a concern with this region spec is that if you have a browser that does not support regions, then you'll have the layout below the content just displayed with that style that you've used for that layout. And some purists may not like having all these empty divs. You know, you want it to be as semantic as possible and whatnot. So there's a way you can work with this with the Shadow DOM and the web component stuff is that hide all the layout stuff into the the component that you're using and only have the content be part of that element. So here is it with Shadow DOM. And so here you notice there's only the P elements, nothing else. There's no layout anymore. So, but it still renders in the same way. It still has that flow going through. And the way that happens is you have on the network, you have the regions, and I have the layout section here. And one thing to note is that even though I'm using regions within a specific component, I'm still using the styles from the parent. And the way I would do this is as soon as I instantiate that Shadow DOM, I would make sure that I'm applying author style so that it flows, the styles apply from the parent to the Shadow DOM itself. So let's look at the other specs. So the other spec that's recently out is called the Variables. It's a very wrong name for the spec because it's actually just custom CSS property. And at best, it'll have a value like a string fragment. So it's just a string fragment that you can use anywhere. And the way it would work is you'd have a selector, and then you'd have a var prefix, and then the property name, and then the value that you'll be using in that property. And then the way you'd use it is use another selector, and then you'd set a normal CSS property with a var function and pass the parameter as the property name that you just used. And one thing to note is that this is the variables are also scoped to the specificity of the selector where you first defined them. So in this case, you have the section, and then you have the var my property. So if you're using, if you're trying to get the value of my property in the body selector, it'll be undefined. So that's something that is not immediately obvious to you. And if you have, if you cringe at this syntax, I do too, but there is no way out. This is what the CSS working group has decided will be the syntax for CSS variables. So here is, if you realize we have this variable here as a value for this background, let's set it and see how that. So I'll put minus webkit. And then it gets applied. And now CSS variables are pretty important to the web components because, as Angelina said, the styles do not quite flow into. So if you have a if you have a span, if you want to style a span of the children of the content that go into the Shadow DOM, you can't do that from within the component itself. You need to do it from the parent. And that's not sometimes easy, and you may want to, you know, that kind of separation is kind of hard to get. So you may want to pass on these parameters as values by using CSS variables and style your Shadow DOM components using those variables. So the last spec I would like to talk about are custom filters. How many of you know about shaders? Wow. A lot of people. That's much more than I expected. So so shaders are something that you use in typically in WebGL. And what they would do is they just apply some textures onto your WebGL model and then render it on a canvas element. But what custom filters does is to do the exact same thing, but on HTML elements. And so you can have different kinds of effects. But so you could have textures, and you could have some sort of wobbly effect and all of that on your HTML element. And this is all part of a specification called the filter effects. And filter effects specification provides some native filter effects as well. So those native filter effects could be like blur, sepia, grayscale. And those are all available in Chrome Stable and Safari 6. But this custom filters is only available in Chrome Canary for now. And there's also a filter lab that's like a tool to help you edit shaders and see how they apply on HTML elements. But The syntax for how that works is that you'll have a selector, and then you'll have a filter property, and then you'll have a function called custom, and then you'll pass the URL for the shader, and then the parameters for that shader itself. And what the browser will do is then it'll select all the elements that match that particular selector, and then render it off screen and make a model of it, and then have a lot of vertices, and it will then apply those shaders to that model, and then finally render it on screen again. So the thing is, after it's all rendered, it's still live text. So it means you can still select the text and do things with the text. So let's look at how this would work. So this is, let me extend it. So this is, I'm not sure if you can see, there's a subtle fabric light effect that you can see if you hover on it. And this is the photo of Dimitri Glasgow, who is the primary leading person doing the web component spec. This is how we have the content. So we have left content, we have right content, and then look at the component itself. So I have banner, I have the filter that's being applied, and then I have a transition. I could have done an animation, but there's a bug, and I'll come to that a little bit later. And then I have the content select, and then I select the left container, the left content, the right content, and so on. So that's pretty trivial. So the other thing I want to show is that you can reuse reuse the same component but apply different content to it. So you'll have a H2 class is equal to left content. So as long as you have the same class name, you're safe. So as if the H2 has a left content, that will be displayed, which is what is being displayed on the left. And same with the right content. So if you notice, our component does not have, it only renders. Let's look at the component itself. So it only renders content that is of certain class names. It does not render any other content. So if you look here in this example, there is a P class, it's called M is normal or whatever shit that you'll see on the web. And that will not be rendered on the screen because you only are scoping the content to be rendered to the specific class names that you want. So if the users or the authors provide you like a bunch of content, you can make sure that you can ignore them and not render it at all. And not just that, you can also apply different components. So here in this case, I have and I have banner. Instead of banner, I say banner accordion. Wait. This one. Banner accordion, and I have the variable height set to new content. And let's look at how. So this is, I'm just using an accordion. It's the same content, but I just changed it to a different component, and now it looks like it's a accordion or whatever that's supposed to be. So it's like a hero control. So depending on what component you use, you can just reuse the same content, but just make it display differently. You can even have this display as an SVG or anything that you like. So so you can pass on the same content, but then the component will decide how it will render or even how it will interact. So there are some things that you should keep in mind, though. And that's what I talked about. So as Angela said, the shadow DOM subtree styles don't apply to the element's children. So I want to show how that manifests itself. If you look at the button here, so now I have a new span within that button. So this span will become part of the content for the template that we are using. So here is the template that we are using. So we have style, and then we have content. Now that span will be within this content tag. But I have this style here then. So I have span background red, and it should ideally apply, right? Because I have the span, it's part of the child. Logically, that makes sense. Except the spec says, no, that won't happen. So the only way you can do that is if I actually apply this here, and I will see that it works now, because it's the child element of the button itself and not part of the shadow DOM. So you have to be aware of that. And then there are still bugs about style scoping implementations, which is why I couldn't do fancy custom filters on animation for keyframe animations. And then, shockingly, font phase is not supported, so you can't use your terrible fonts to showcase how awesome web components are. And I would definitely have you read the explainer, and that link is valid as of yesterday. It's just a Git repo, and just go to that location and look for the tip and make sure you're reading the latest explainer. And I took about a few months to understand what is all this is about. And the explainer is very interesting too, contrary to how usually specs are. And there's also a Google Plus account for web components. And it does a good job of showcasing what other people are saying or doing with respect to web components. And then Dmitry Glazkov himself has a Twitter account, and he's also on Google Plus. And there are a bunch of people working on the web component specifications, and they're all very responsive, and they're actively seeking your feedback. So please do give them feedback and make sure it does not end up as maybe the video API. So that's all I have. My slides are up on nimble.in/jsconf.eu. But before I go, I just wanted to pitch event that we are organizing with W3C called Test the Web Forward, where hackers and speculators come together to write tests to make sure that browsers are not buggy when they claim to implement something. So if you are a web developer and you live near Paris and you're free that weekend, please come and join us. So that's all I have. Thanks.
How does the Shadow DOM work with accessibility, if at all?
I have no idea right now. I don't think it's even in the there is no such I don't know if there's an accessibility API implemented already for Shadow DOM. I don't think it is. But for now, if you the is attribute is ignored, so the screen readers will typically just read the content of within that element. So if you have no content, then nothing will be read. I don't think it'll be, it's not accessible unless you have content within that element, for now. But I'm sure it'll improve as soon as there's more Shadow DOM support. But I think with respect to video form controls, there might be APIs already associated, because I'm pretty sure that's implemented in Chrome. But that's only for native implementations of the Shadow DOM, for the video Chrome and stuff like that.
Hey, yes. Thanks for your talk. Just one question. How is it with events happening inside of the shadow routes? Are they bubbling up to the normal DOM, to the outer window, or just are they also encapsulated in the shadow route?
Typically, they're mostly encapsulated. Dmitry Glazkov has a recent post on how they recently solved the problem of how to expose the events selectively to the parent DOM, and I'm not quite sure on the specifics, but you should go read his post on that.
Okay, thank you very much, Divya.